लाइक मतलब डेली आई हैव टू सी दैट वेदर टुमारो आई हैव टू ज्वाइन बैंक और नॉट, मींस आई कैन गेट एनी टाइम टर्मिनेशन नोटिस, लाइक यू नो,
No,
लाइक
that is
इफ आई
fine. I think I agree with you on this. That I would not, if given a chance, I would move, you know, tomorrow itself to some other country. But the thing is that let's talk about the academic part of it. As in, how do you conceive IELTS? As an immigration is something else, which is of course the need of the RAs. But how do you perceive this one? Do you think it's a difficult test or an easy one or something? What are your
Yes,
notions about it?
basically I have done my schooling from convent school, so I don't think that will be difficult for me. So I
It's
just
good
want
to
to
be
clear
confident,
this.
yeah.
Yeah, I just want to clear this test so that I can give any interview for work. Like I can give any interview over there. So basically,
Perfectly
my
fine.
main sir, I just want to tell you that basically my main motive is to earn money and to have a good future. Like,
I think that's the mantra, anywhere it
yeah,
is.
yes, sir. Because there's no day, like, when you wake up in the morning, you need at least a minimum, like a middle family need 1,000 rupees to spend per day. So I think there is no other scope. So I have to,
So
like,
I now consider you a rational, I now consider you a rational person. So I'll be happy to teach you. And since you are completely new to this field, so I can be sure of the fact that you will trust me on whatever I'm teaching. Because, okay, first of all, there is a lot of you know, air outside that this exam is something that you should be preparing too much about it, that you should be preparing, you should be following this format or that format. English has never had any formats. First of all, this is the thing. English is not mathematics that you have to follow certain formulae or you have to tread some paths. It has always been reflex. It has always been flexible. It has always been perspective driven. It has always been fluid. There is nothing that you have to follow in order to excel at English. So there is a lot. There are so many YouTubers. There are so many. First of all, they teach IELTS in Punjabi, which is the biggest ironical thing I've seen in my life. And then
yes,
they
sir.
have given so many, I would say, tips and tricks, which I don't be okay. My case has been a bit, you know, different because people go from IELTS and all to some higher level exams. But what I have done is that I have come from GMAT,
Yes,
CAT,
sir. So even I have
LSAT.
played cat. Yes,
So I've come from these exams to IELTS, which
sir.
has been a, I would say, a path of my life, as in it is nothing that I was forced to do so, but there have been some bad experiences that I have had to leave Career Launcher. I, you know me through Anisha, so you know I used to teach GMAT to her.
Sir, actually, I have myself have done CAT preparation from Career Launcher, and
Which year?
I was just from Career Launcher only.
Which
Like
year?
it
Which
was,
year?
sir, 2014 or 15.
So I joined CL for this thing in the year 2017.
And sir, I was just able to clear GNDU exam.
No, that see, I was trained at Career Launcher headquarters for this thing, for
Yes,
all these
sir.
exams. But IELTS is a baby. First of all,
Yes.
it's not that I say that you don't have to prepare for it. I say prepare for one because it's an exam you have to prepare. So prepare for 1 month and that's completely fine. You can sail through it, but there is so much of, I would say, you know, there's a word in you know, it's over the top English, ballyhoo. There's a lot of ballyhoo on the internet regarding this exam that this has it has created a phobia in the minds of people. Okay, this
Yes,
is
sir.
going so that phobia we okay. Most of the teachers who will say such things, no, they don't have taken the exam ever. First thing is this. I can't name names, first of all, but whichever teacher you see on the internet, whichever is giving tips and tricks and 7 din mein 7 band kind of things, they haven't taken the exams themselves. First of all,
Yes.
that proves their worth. And apart from that, when they are doing such things, they are actually propagating misinformation, which is affecting the students also. They are not able to sail through this exam, and then the whole, I would say,
So
influence of this exam.
they are just trying their luck. Like if a student will be cleared, he'll definitely praise the teacher, and if nothing will happen, they'll shift to different other center. So it's basically like this only.
You know, the worst part of this is that, you know, the most students who come for this, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Sorry. Could you speak again? Sorry. I was changing the volume.
Yes, sir. I can hear you properly.
So the saddest part regarding this exam is that most students come from villages.
Yes,
and they have a lot of money, nothing to deny that. So you
sir,
know
they don't have money because I'm working in HDFC Bank and my posting is in Majita branch. So okay. It's a remote area. So basically their parents just sell their land and everything just to send their one child. Like you might be aware, like one agent takes approximately 18 to 20 lakhs. Means their parents are paying like that. And they
the preparation only, sorry to cut you. For the preparation only, I can't again name names, but there is an institute in Amritsar. There are many institutes in Amritsar. And they're charging in the range of 12,000 per month. There's one institution, there's one institute that charges about 18 to 19,000 per month. Now, is that fair, first of all? Is that fair,
first of all? That is not fair, sir. That is seriously not fair. Because this exam is also very expensive. Now, it's not like paying just a few pennies. It's like giving 15,000.
15,000.
Yeah. And so basically, students over here, so most of the students are just manipulated by the agents and they just take, they just charge them money only. So like they're charging 1 lakh, we'll give you, you just give us 1 lakh and we'll give you PR or we'll give you study basis visa over there. So
because of such malpractices, this exam has been actually blemished a lot and there's a lot of hoopla around it, which has no meaning. It is not difficult, honestly, but most teachers don't know what to teach. The problem is that they have been teaching English like they have been teaching IELTS as they teach English in India in general. But these two are different. There are some nuances. Because English for us is a glamorous thing. English for the English people is something very normal. What Hindi is to us is English is to them. You know, is what English is to them. So the problem in regard to the fact that we have been teaching an immigration exam in the way we teach our own English, our Indian style English, is something that is creating the problem. And that has led to the whole hoopla, which has no meaning, which has no, you know, there was one student of mine, Rahat Pesha Baria, and she just attended about 20 classes. You must have heard this thing that students attend classes for 3 months, 4 months, and they still are getting 5.5. And
yes,
she just
attended.
So I'm going to show you something. One second. So can you see my blog?
Yes, sir.
So none of my students have been with me for more than 1 month, but there have been some who have been there with me for only about 20 days, 25 days. For instance, this girl, she was there with me for only 20 days.
She's Rahat Pishoria, sir. She was my classmate in...
She's a famous makeup artist now.
Yeah, she was my classmate in Sacred Heart. Like we have done plus one, plus two.
A great student by any means. And she was very, she was also a very rational person. She was also like, whatever I used, she has been, okay, she was a celebrity, but she still considered me her teacher only. And she followed what I said. And you know, in 20 days, banned it. People have been struggling to get 6.5 in 3-4 months by paying 20-30,000 per month. And that's where the, you know, conundrum is. Then this guy, Parth Patel, again banned it. And they're all on my Instagram. And if you ask them, he was there with me for about 16-17 days and that too online classes. Arlene, she was there with me for 1 month, no doubt, and banned it. And then there have been some who have gotten 7.5, this girl, that thing, general training thing. So 8777 requirement. So again, so most of my students have been able to get, scores beyond 7. Okay, this guy, this So when you know, people have been there who have said, who have actually tried to pinpoint problems so that the student stays with them for longer. So they would try to pick out some points that are not there. So they would say, you are going to get a little, you know, a small score in, a bad score in speaking or something. I am seeing this on an online platform and I might upload this video on YouTube also. I told this person on the very first day that you are going to get a band 8 in speaking. You don't need to work on that because he was already so good at it. Mm-hmm. I also said that if you don't work on your writing, because I had, you know, I had seen his writing samples and all, you're not gonna, I said, you are good at language and all, but you're not a good writer. So if you don't work on that, you're not gonna get a score beyond 6 in writing, but speaking, I assure you, you will get a, at, in the worst case scenario, a 7.5, but but most probably an 8. And that happened to it. So the thing is that we as, you know, Indians, we have been studying English for so long. So there are two parts to IELTS. First, you have to know the formats. Second, you have to have English. Since we have been learning, our mediums of, our media of instructions have been only, you know, in English. So we know that English part mostly. You know, IELTS is not a PhD part. First of all, that vocabulary thing, please, you do not need to be Shashi Tharoor to sail through IELTS. They don't require any kind of fancy vocabulary. They are just requiring something very, very surface level, basic. And that is something, if you write something very, very, I would say, over the top, no, you get a, you know, I would say, you get a worse score than you're going to get when you write simply. So that is something, my first tip to you would be that try to be as simple as you can be. Simplicity is the thing. It's not that the more glamorous the words are, the higher your score is going to be, nothing of that sort, but that is a general perception among student, among students, and that is harming their scores like an atomic weapon or something. So be, that is my first, I would say, as a teacher, my first guideline to you. And then most have been sevens and all. So the thing is that it's not that difficult. This girl was from a famous institute, Amritsar. I will not again name the name because I might upload this video. So she was also, you know, battered by them. She was like, I'm not able to sail through this exam. She had attended the classes for about 2 months. So she came to me. Then I devoted 2 months to her. She was from a village and Tarantaran. So this was the first one actually I devoted 2 months to. So she, again, she got a band 7. So again, if a girl, who doesn't have an English background can get a 7, then how difficult do you think this exam is? Not at all difficult. But right. Again, certain parameters you have to follow, but that is not rocket science that I should be charging 20,000 for. So let's begin with the exam now, First of all, the websites you're going to follow for this exam are my blog, first of all. Because all the material is over there, what I'm going to teach you. And then this website by IELTS themselves. There are many mentors on the internet. You don't have to follow any of them. And this website, IELTS.IDP.com, is the one you're going to follow for your preparation, apart from my blog. IELTS.com, as simple as that. Fine, Isha?
Yes, sir, I have noted.
Good. So now we are going to start with the format of the exam, or are you privy to it? Do you know what the format is?
No, sir. I'm totally new to this.
Fine. We'll start with that only.
And sir, yesterday you were asking like whether I want to give this online or offline. So is there any difference between that?
For the online one, you have to be more spontaneous than you have to be for the offline one, because all you have to type and I personally prefer online one because I've been doing these things for long. This GMAT is online, this CAT is online. So I've been through this, but I have seen people struggling with this format of the exam because they are not, because you have to type very fast and all those things. So they are not very adept at it. So they face difficulties. So if you are a good typist, you can go for CDI. It's also the only benefit that I can tell you is that they give results sooner when you take CDIs, 3-4 days. And when you take the paper pencil mode, you get the result in 13 days.
So, which is more convenient according to you?
To me, okay. to me it was always serious because I think I'm better at typing than I'm at writing. But again, it has to be your subjectivity, like what you think you are better at. Do you think you're a better writer or better typist?
Okay, sir. So basically they check writing also, na? Like because my writing is not that good.
Handwriting, it has no points.
That only I'm asking.
No, handwriting has no points. See, one sec, this website. So the first time I took it, it was CDIs. First time was this one. This was CDIs. And this one was also CDIs. So I've scored better in CDIs than I've scored in the paper pencil mode. Two times I've taken CDIs, this one 8.5 and this one 8.5. But the one time I went for this paper pencil mode, I got a band, like it was reduced by half. So I generally think that I'm better at that thing. So again, up to you.
Yes, sir.
Completely individual, I would say. So, okay, let's start. So I is basically, okay, it is showing Ishan. What's your name? Isha or Ishan? Sorry.
So my name is Isha. Ishan is my brother's name.
Okay.
Sorry. My younger
brother's name.
We are three siblings.
I thought I've added a boy today. So that is the guy whom I'm teaching. But then you spoke and I got to know that this is Isha. Okay. Isha IELTS academic. Is conducted mostly on 2 days. Okay, it can be a 1 day process also, but that's rare. On 1 day, you take LRW, listening, reading, writing. On the next, on the other day, which can be before or after, you take the speaking test. So we're gonna start with the writing test today, which is the most controversial one among them. And have you received your books?
No, sir. I will be receiving most late by 13th or 14th.
Fine. It's okay. Like listening and reading are comparatively, you know, easy than speaking and writing. Again, they are not, again, difficult, just the comparison thing. So we're going to start with the writing part today.
Okay, sir.
What happens in the writing part is that you get two tasks. Writing, last 1 hour, first of all. In which you get two tasks. Task one, task two. Task one is a summary in which you are presented with a picture that can either be pictorial. You don't have to take notes. First of all, this is being recorded. And then whatever you need to write is there on the blog. So you just, I would recommend that you just concentrate on the thing.
Yes, sir.
Or it can be an infographic. Task two is an essay. And there are certain types of essays, as in what you get about, as in I'll guide you on them. One sec. Agree, disagree, essay, discussion, essay. And again, this is not something I should be burdening you with, that you have to follow this format or that format. Nothing, just the names, discussion, essay, agree, disagree, problem, solution, nothing Shakespearean. So in task one, you have to write 150 words at least. So the length can be, I would say, greater than or equal to 150. And here it is 250, at least 250. You can go beyond that, no problem. In my real exam, when I got a 7.5 in writing, I'd written about 30 words in writing task two and about 180, 190 words in task one. So there's no problem with going beyond the limit. But if you stay under that, that's going to be an issue. So today we'll start with task two, which is of, as in the weightage of task two is twice as the weightage of task one. In layman terminology, I would say band 6, band 3, band 6 task 2, band 3 task 1, but that is something very, very fundamental and I think stupid also. I would say the weightage is this. If the weightage of task 1 is X, that of task 2 is 2X. So task 2, and you can divide your time according to your convenience. You don't have to be like you have, there is no stipulation of this regard that you have to spend this proportion of 1 hour of the 1 hour on this task and that proportion on that task. It's up to you. You can spend 55 minutes on task 2 and 5 minutes on task 1, up to you. What is generally recommended is that you should spend 20 minutes on task 1 and 40 minutes on task 2. But personally, I actually have to spend 30-30 on both, but that again, that's the later stage. So you will, when you have mastered the basics, we'll come to that. Task 2 is an essay which will present you with a statement and then a question. Now that question can be that, do you agree or disagree?
Yes, sir.
What are some causes of this? And solutions and all. Then I would say discuss both views and give your opinion. Or it could be, as in, there are, is this a positive or a negative development? So nothing to be, nothing that you have to cram. Just I'm telling you the generics that I've seen. So what happens is that, you know, writing in this, this is not, again, I would say, an Indian examination. It is going to take you to Canada. So, or wherever you want to go, sorry. So they have certain parameters that you have to follow in order to get a good score in writing. And writing honestly requires so much that fulfilling all those conditions in the 1 hour is something I would say Samsonian. It's like heroic. You have to be, I can show you something one sec. Okay, I don't say 7.5 in writing is a bad score, but I still feel like I lagged a bit in this. But if you see in other exams, like I've taken almost, okay, so in TOEFL, I got 27 and 30 in writing. Then in PTE, I got 88 or 19 writing. Duolingo doesn't have any you know, segments, so it's an overall score only. And then I've done a course from an American college, Fresno City, and that also, you know, there I learned only essays, as in the first kind of essay, if you can see, autobiographical essay or cause and effect essay. Then maybe there was this essay, identify a problem essay, then problem solution essay. That I performed well in that. I got a 91.5% from an American professor. So the thing is that, but it's not that I'm blaming IELTS. There are so many requirements to be fulfilled in that 1 hour that it becomes difficult to reach that band 8.5 or 9 in writing. And now I show you why. Writing is actually evaluated on the basis of certain descriptors called band descriptors, and I'm going to show you them, and you can download them from the blog under the category I would say band descriptors. If you open the menu, you get a category, you get a tab band descriptors, and there you can download them. So I'm going to show you them right now. Can you see them? Writing task to band descriptors.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there are four parameters on the basis of which your writing is tested. The first is task response. The second is coherence and cohesion. The third is lexical resource. And the fourth one is grammatical range and accuracy. Now, if we see task response, it says that how you actually deal with the question. The language is the second thing. Not the second thing, but one of the things. But the first thing is that you answer the question well, which is a main problem with the kids that have, you know, have to, that was one of the problems with the guy Vishesh also. Like when I had to, I told him that you're not focusing on the right things. you know, in spite of your good command of the language, so you'll not get a good score in writing. So here you are actually told to answer the question. Ideas matter here. It is not that the questions are going to be very, very scientific or very, very knowledge based, but honestly, we Indians tend to, I would say, get off track very soon. Whatever we are asked, as in we try, mostly whenever it is not, you know, gelling well with our, you know, mental abilities, we tend to give something related to it rather than focusing on the point on, you know, whatever is there in front of us. So, for instance, if I even ask you what are some advantages and disadvantages of demonetization, you would list so many because you are a commerce girl. But the thing is that they have asked for something. If you see task response band 9, fully addresses all parts of the task. So first of all, you have to be addressing all parts. You can't do this thing that you answer one question and then you don't focus properly on the second one if there are two questions or something. And that to fully, that to whatever the requirements are. Presents a fully developed position in answer to the question with relevant, fully extended and well-supported ideas. So if you only give ideas, you're not going to get a good score and you're not going to get a band 9 in task response. He has said that points should be relevant. They should be fully extended. Now, what do you understand by fully extended, if I may ask you, Isha?
Sir, all the, like, I have to give all my views in negative perspective also and in positive perspective.
No, fully extended means that whatever idea you're giving, you should be explaining it. It is not that, okay, Isha, I give you an example. If to Anisha, you say this thing that ice cream will give you illness, she will understand what the underlying bases are. But if you say this same thing to a grade 2 student, ice cream will give you illness. So you will be explaining like when it goes through your throat, it is going to affect the temperature and all. And that is how you're going to get an illness. You don't have to say these things to Isha, but you have to be very, very elaborated. You know, you have to have your points very, very elaborated when you are explaining the same thing to a grade 2 student. So that explanation has to be there, which is sometimes not the cup of tea for Indian students. But that is the thing, you have to be explaining whatever you are saying, and then you have to support them. Supporting is that what I follow for the support thing is that I give an example. A good support is an example, I would say. So what I do is that I take an idea, I explain it, and then I give an example for that one. Now, as you make blunders in these basic fundamentals that relevant, extended, and supported, and also fully, your score goes down. Now, if you see the difference between band 9 and band 8, fully addresses all parts of the task, band 9. 8 says sufficiently addresses all parts of the task. Now, you have explained the thing. It is relevant.
I have told the thing, but not but explained well.
No. You have explained it. Very good. But you have not explained it well. It could have been better.
Yes, sir. So, in this, is presentation a matter or not? Like, presentation. When we are writing 250 words, do we need to write in on one page or make few paragraphs? Like
that is a part of coherence and cohesion. I'll come to that. Four parameters: task response, coherence and cohesion, lexical resource. So I'll tell you all those things. Paragraphing is of utmost importance. If you don't have paragraphing skills, but again, that is not something I would say that I'm going to be. I'm going to be Jesus by telling you that. That is very simple. Just I'm going to remind you what the paragraphing thing is. You know it already, just that you'll get to know what to do. So if you see band 7, addresses all parts of the task, presents a clear position throughout the response, presents extends and supports main ideas, but there may be a tendency to overgeneralize and or supporting ideas may lack focus. So now your ideas are out of focus a little. So I'm giving you the peak. If you're going to get a band 9 in task response, one idea, explain, example, and bang on. Nothing beyond that. And if we go through the inappropriacies now, they are not going to bear any fruit. 6 will say that if you see 6, addresses all parts of the task, although some parts may be more fully covered than others. Now, there is a question, advantages, disadvantages. And you have given two advantages, one disadvantage. That will give you a 6. Addresses all parts of the task, although some parts may be more fully covered than others. You like covered we have advantage.
We have to maintain balance.
Yeah. That is what it is saying, no? That you have covered some parts more fully than others. So if you do that, you get a band 6. So now, have you understood the criteria? Task response, that your points should be relevant. They should be, they should be spot on. They should be right. They should be related to the topic. Then they should be explained. Then they should be supported. And that gives you a band 9 in task response. Now, I don't say that with bad grammar, you will get a good score. The testing is a bit holistic. They are interconnected. But then again, I have to teach you the ABC. So I'll be focusing on one thing at a time. Comes coherence and cohesion, which again is a problem with us. Now, what happens is that we kind of think that the more complex the thing is, the better it is. Which is actually the case that is vice versa in IELTS. The simpler the thing is, the better your score is. So coherence and cohesion is mostly marred by the fact that you write two long sentences, first of all. For instance, by you, I don't mean you, but generally, people write things like this because I've evaluated so many tasks. The major problem with this thing is that you do not consider the aspect that I said in that condition, but that condition was nothing. Why to write such a long sentence? You can always break things up, no?
Mm-hmm.
You can always have segments, and that is what good writing is about, that you are able to say things clearly. You know where to stop. So coherence and cohesion is very much dependent on your sentence, I would say length, how you actually are able to present. You know, if I'm able to understand your essay in one go, you're going to score very high in coherence and cohesion. One aspect of this is that your ideas should be logical. They should be easy to read, first of all. It is not that, okay, there's one word student, there's one word protege. Both mean similar things. Protege, in spite of being a fancier term, is going to get you a lower score. So student is a band 9 word. There's no problem in that. Okay. Student, which might seem contradictory to here, is a band 9 word. You don't need to be beyond that. Don't use any kind of, I would say, literary language. This is not, you are not writing literature. So don't go over the top. Then the first part, as I told you, should be simple and short. Then, if you see, skillfully manages paragraphing, band 9.
Yes,
the first feature was uses cohesion in such a way that it attracts no attention. Skillfully manages paragraphing. And paragraphing is something that would be clearer to you when you see the band, I would say 7, bullet point 3. One sec. This one. Now, this is the clincher. This is the settling point. Presents a clear central topic within each paragraph. One paragraph, one idea. That is the kind of paragraphing that you need in your IELTS exam. If you are giving an advantages, disadvantages essay, so one paragraph, one advantage. The next paragraph, another advantage, then disadvantage. So one paragraph should focus on one idea.
Yes.
You get me?
Yes, sir.
I can be sure of what I'm saying. First of all, I've scored in IELTS, and then I can see if you see this thing. Sorry. So when I was doing that course, essay writing course, okay, this will not have the, I would say, the fragmentation. Okay, I'll show you that someday. So there was one criterion called body paragraphs. They also have their rubrics. I might have it on my phone. So there was, okay, one essay was of 150 marks. And out of that, 70 marks were given to paragraphing, body paragraphs. And I got 69 on 70. So that's why I'm sure about what I'm saying, that it's not the, I would say, a clunky mixture of too many ideas. It should not be focusing on like one paragraph, seven advantages. That is going to be, I would say, a killer. So this might be visible to you. Can you, okay, sorry. This is brightness is too high. Can you see something on the screen?
Yes, sir.
One sec.
But it's not that
not visible. No problem. I'm going to WhatsApp it to you. Okay. So if you see, sorry. Isha sent it to you personally, not in the group. So if you see the third criterion, body paragraphs, provides details and support the and support for the thesis statement with focused paragraphs. So I got 69-70. This is one of the essays, but I've written four essays in the whole course. And my body paragraphs used to be getting high scores. So you can see that this is what they are asking also, that the paragraphs should be focused on one idea. Okay. So one idea should not go beyond more than one idea.
So like if in an essay we are in support of that statement, so can we go negative, means against that statement in other paragraph or not?
Okay, if I will be explaining that now. So when we read the task response thing, okay, the marking is done according to these criteria. When we saw the task response thing, did he say the perspective of the person is very good? The perspective of the person is very positive. No, there is no requirement for that. It is up to you. You can bash the idea. You can support the idea. You can do anything. It's up to you. You can be as negative as Anurag Kashyap in this essay, and there's no problem in that. But you should be explaining the thing, what the requirements were.
Yes, sir.
Do you
get me? Means can we have a balance in between or like?
Suppose you have blah blah blah. Do you agree or disagree? You can always say I partly agree. Then you will be writing one agree, one disagree thing. Up to you. You can be completely agreeing. So you'll be writing two agree points. You can completely disagree. Then you will be writing two disagree points. They can be three also, up to you. And it is in your screen sharing is post. Can you see the descriptors?
Yes, sir.
Are descriptors visible to you?
Yes, sir. Everything is visible.
Okay. There's a message over there that your screen sharing is paused. I thought. Okay. So the thing is that even you can do this, do a thing of this sort. I disagree more than I agree. I disagree more than I agree. And in that case, you can write two disagree points and one agree point. That is also fine.
Fine, sir.
Fine. So it's up to you. Whatever is there should be balanced, should be detailed, should be supported. And it's not a test of your psychology. So you can be as cynical as you want to be, pessimistic and all, nothing, no problem. Then another aspect of this, okay, you got the paragraphing thing, you got the simple simplicity wins thing. Now comes another, I would say, parameter of coherence and cohesion, and that is cohesive devices. They are honestly already there in your writing, like if, because, all those things. And there should be something of this sort also, nonetheless, however, but don't overdo it. As in, I've seen people writing, I would say, these cohesive devices in every sentence, and that irritates. So I had a student, so he was so much marred by one of the institutes that once I, whenever he used to write something, he used to write it like this. In this contemporary era, blah, blah, blah has happened. In this contemporary era, blah, blah, blah. I one day asked him what the term means, contemporary era, and he was blank. I once asked him, I sent a WhatsApp message, and then I asked, do you use Google Pay? He said, in this contemporary era, I don't have time for such activities. So they have been so robotic. They have been made so robotic that they don't understand what they're saying. And these cohesive devices, I would say illness is a part of that, and they use cohesive devices in every sentence, which is a turn off. Don't do that. Five in the whole exam, five in the whole essays, I think, and up to the mark degree. So I'm going to make you do one essay with me, so you will see what those are. So three parameters, and you are going to get a bang on score in coherence and cohesion. Comes lexical resource, which is vocabulary. Now, I'm going to sound a bit awkward to you, because whichever website you're going to refer to will say one thing, that you have to paraphrase the statement. Paraphrasing is that you have to write the question in your own words.
Mm-hmm.
That is not required. I challenge every teacher. I challenge even English teachers and, people from, foreign countries who are native English people. Show me where they have asked for paraphrasing the whole band descriptors chart. They have never said that. A good essay doesn't require paraphrasing at all. You just have to write an introduction. Of course, you should not be copying words from the given, I would say, statement. But that doesn't mean that you have to write a synonym of each and every word. What students do is that, suppose the statement is like this. In many countries, this has happened. People will write, in a lot of nations, this has transpired or occurred. This is not wrong. This is not bad, but this is not a good introduction. An essay should be introduced well. It should be something that should attract the reader, that the person is the person knows what he's going to do. So an introduction should not take words from the given prompt. That is appropriate, but you should not be very much focused on the fact that you have to change each and every word given in the prompt. They have never asked for it, and the descriptors are in front of you. You can, you can scrutinize them. You can have an in-depth examination of them, and you will never find a word called paraphrase in these descriptors. That is just their own philosophy, and that is not required. This I'm telling you because you're going to search for such things on the internet, which is a human tendency, and you are free to do that. And you're going to get this thing that you have to paraphrase the statement. That is not wrong. I don't say that is wrong, but that can mislead you. So a paraphrasing is not required. A paraphrase is not required in an IELTS essay at all. Good vocabulary would mean changing terms at certain points. And people have been so much, they are demented about these synonyms that, first I've written human. Now I should write individual. Now I should write this. People have been writing language, language of this sort. They will say denizens. No, denizens is a very, very old, it's a very obsolete term. For instance, when we talk in Hindi, would you ever say, Isha, to your mother, bahar ek manushya aaya hai? Though manushya and aadmi are not different, but does that sound right? No. That would sound awkward. You are going to stay in a foreign land, and are you going to speak, language of this sort? So if manushya is awkward to us, denizen is awkward to them. So there is one thing that is required here. I show you. Just that in order to write a very fancy term that is alien to most people, you should not be distorting the collocation. I give an example of a collocation. For instance, drawback. Have you heard this term? Drawback.
Yes,
in place of saying gigantic drawback, gigantic is a term for huge. We mostly say major drawback, major.
Yes, sir.
So major drawback is a band 9 collocation. Whereas if you write gigantic drawback, that is awkward. That is going to get you a lower score. So in order to just fit in an awkward word that seems to you fancy, but is going to irritate the examiner, do not distort these collocations and all. another collocation I can tell you one sec. On the other hand, heard of it?
Yes, sir.
So these are, you already have them in your writing. Don't take any extra stress for that. Just that I've cleared it out to you so that you know what the exam requires. And you know, one synonym is more than enough in your writing. You people go crazy about synonyms. Like they're gonna fill the whole I would say paper with synonyms. But IELTS forbids that. I show you. I'm not going to follow the website of any teacher or anything. I'm just following the... Okay, if you're taking a CBSE exam, the most reliable source is going to be the CBSE. So what, that is what I'm going to do. I'm going to show you the website of IELTS itself, not any teacher on the internet or anything. Not even mine also. One sec. Okay, is it visible?
Yes, sir.
So, Isha, I know that you know the concept of do's and don'ts. So, let's see this thing. I give you this entertainment thing today. Go through as many teachers as you can on the the platform YouTube, and you will see that most will say your essay should be. You know, replete with, it should be full of synonyms and all. But see what IELTS says.
Use less common vocabulary, it was written.
And spell less, less common, okay, that is confused a bit. Less common, okay, generate. What do you think? Is it less common vocabulary or a very common vocabulary?
Generate.
Generate is a band 9 word. I'm telling you this. Generate, fancier than this is going to be awkward. You could actually, as in, okay, there's a word school, there's a word frontistry. Both mean the same. To an Indian, you know, this word frontistry is going to tickle. And he will tend to write that, but the examiner won't understand it, and the person will get a lower score. So generate, these are less common. Major drawback, an excellent term for IELTS. Nothing beyond this.
Yes, sir.
You know, do you know the English part related to Shahid Tharoor, as in, you know how fancy his vocabulary is. For instance, farago he uses, which means chaos. Not at all required. It will actually do the opposite. Now see, people will be like, teachers will be going bananas over the fact that you should be, you know, overdoing your essay with synonyms. But see what IELTS says. IELTS says, don't overuse synonyms. One is enough.
Yeah.
For a band 8 essay, which I even have not been able to get, I've gotten a 7. I don't know whether my task 1 was worse or task 2, but I have an overall of 7.5. So for band 8, they have said, don't overuse synonyms. One is enough. Now, at the start, I told you these stupid terms, no? Old-fashioned language. And go for a demo class at any institute. You will see that teacher will first of all write the masses. It's such a masses again, as I told you, manushya. Uh-huh. Or would you say sabji wale denizen idhar aaja or something like, okay. One second. Perhaps something. Okay, maybe mama bhojan de do. Again, bhojan and khana are not different, but bhojan is awkward in everyday life, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So that is the case there also. Mask. What I tell you what the problem is. What they do is that they Google this term and they'll get a list of it. Okay. You're good. You are now the king or the queen of synonyms. Use any as many as you want, but that is self-harm. Okay. So don't use any awkward vocabulary. Student, pupil, good. Maybe protege, or maybe then what they say is that. Okay, there are so many. It's 10 p.m. in the evening, so I'm not at my best. So don't be overdoing things. Idioms and cliches, don't use them. As in apple of my eye or something. Don't love is blind or something. Don't do those things.
Okay? Sir, like in writing an essay, do we need to write a proverb like or not? Not required.
Yes, idioms and cliches are a no-no. Academic writing, it is no. Cliches are gissipity things like as in love is blind or maybe as you sow, so shall you reap. Don't use such things. Simplicity is the main derivative. Okay.
Right.
Sir. Don't use short terms also. Gonna, can't, doesn't. Contractions are a big no-no. Okay. They'll give you a very high score in speaking, but in writing, they're going to do the opposite thing. When I teach you the speaking part, I'll show you the related descriptors, and then you'll get to know how gonna is benefit you in the speaking part. But here, don't use this. Okay. Now, the last okay. So, writing, don't be going, I would say, bananas over that. You have to use as many words as you should, as you want to. It's not about writing a dictionary over there. If you have written at one place you've written humans and in the next place you write individuals, perfectly band 9. Fine?
Right, sir.
Suppose you're writing advantages. At one point you can write benefit. At one point you can write positive aspect. Perfectly fine. If you're writing about disadvantages, one harmful aspect, one drawback, band 9.
Right, sir.
Okay, so this was about vocabulary. Then comes grammar. Grammar, you must, okay, there's a confusing part here also. People will be like going, I would say, savage over it. See, there's one point here I need to show you. Yeah, complex structures. Now, what they do is that they confuse complexity with being complicated. Now, see, there is a term in English called complex sentence, and a complex sentence is of this sort. I'll show you. It is nothing that you have to make a thing complicated. It is just that there's a type of sentence called this complex structure, and I'll show you. It's based on the concept of subordinating conjunctions, but I'll not teach you any kind of technical things. You already know what complex structures are. I'm just going to remind you. One sec. Where's the board? I'm so bad at Zoom. One sec. Oh, it was hidden. Sorry. Okay, do you see a white screen? Isha?
Sir, yes, sir.
So this is a band. Okay, band 9 requires complex structures. No, a complex structure has a condition that it should have a subordinating conjunction. For instance, while, I am here, comma, she is there, full stop. Now, a structure that you make using while is a complex structure, and that is what is required over there. While I am here, she is there. So since teachers don't know what a complex sentence is, they confuse complexity with being complicated, like writing something of this sort. Well, I am here, she is there, which is a fact that is going to irritate him. And it will lead to, okay, they will use fancy terms, repercussions or something of that sort. So that is not required. That is going to give you a lower score in the coherence and cohesion part also. A sentence of, this long sentence is perfectly fine for a band 9. Just that there's one more condition that I'm going to show you. So let's see how the score goes down in GRA. Uses a wide range of structures with full flexibility and accuracy. Rare minor errors occur only as slips. Wide range of structures, as in you use a while structure, you use an in order to structure. I did this in order to get that. Perfectly fine. You use an although sentence. You use an interrogative
like
sentence.
Conjunctions
kind of thing. So you use multiple, as in you used an although structure or something. That it is not that you have to make very long sentences that are going to give you a low score in this and that also. How scores go down is the second parameter. Rare minor errors occur only as slips. So suppose you've written 25 sentences in an essay. So rare minor errors, that means only one or two sentences have errors. Minor errors, you'll get a band 9 in grammar along with the diversity part that I've told you. Then if you see band 8, uses a wide range of structures, the majority of sentences are error free, makes only very occasional errors in errors or inappropriacies. Majority of sentences are error free. Majority means more than 50%. So if you are writing 20 sentences, if more than 10 are perfectly fine, you're going to get a band
8.
Okay, maybe 60-70%, maybe 14-15 sentences are perfectly fine, so you'll get a band 8. Then if you see 7, uses a variety of complex structures, produces frequent error-free sentences. Frequent means one right, maybe the second is wrong, third is right, maybe the fourth is wrong, fifth is wrong, sixth is right. So has good control of grammar and punctuation, but may make a few errors. Most people score a band 6 in grammar. Why? Uses a mix of simple and complex sentence forms, makes some errors in grammar and punctuation, but they rarely reduce communication. So now band 6 doesn't impose a condition that this percentage of your sentences should be correct. It only says that, okay, you have made errors, but in spite of your errors, I'm able to understand what you're trying to say. So that will get you a band 6. For instance, if I say you is there, so you is there is grammatically wrong, but you still understand that I'm referring to someone who is standing over there, and that is a second person. So in spite of the obvious error, since the thing is clear to me, you'll get a band 6. Band 5 is like, may make frequent, third bullet point, may make frequent grammatical errors and punctuation may be faulty. Errors can cause some difficulty for the reader. You is there, that I said. Now, if I say you is daring. Now, this is wrong and this can create confusion, like what the person is saying. Okay, you is daring, but is daring or anything. So this is a band 5 structure.
Right, sir.
Right. So when the class is over, go through the band descriptors and now we'll do an essay. I've already written it. I'll just explain to you the thing. Let's get to the blog now. One sec. Down the alley, you will see worse band descriptors. So you don't need to go through 4, 3, and 1, 4, 3, 2 or something. So it's already, but you need it from the descriptors I've told you. Just revise them after the class. I'll not give you any homework other than that. But they should be on the top of your mind tomorrow so that we can proceed. Now, one sec. I've written many sample essays over here, so you can read them. But now we'll do only one. Writing task 2, that category. And now, if you see, okay. I never say my essay is band 9. I always say band 7 plus. So it can, I'm sure that it will get a band 7 or more than that. But I can't guarantee a band 9. So see, Okay, read the question in your mind and then we'll talk about it.
Yes, sir.
This is a Cambridge essay, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Like the official makers of IELTS. So if you see, you writing task two, you should spend 40 minutes. The statement, then the questions. And then he has said, no, give reasons for your answer and include any relevant examples from your own knowledge or experience. Write at least 250 words. Now, if you see, the question says that blah, blah, blah is the case. And what are the reasons for it? Now he has used a plural term, reasons. That means you can't do the job will not. You can't write only one reason. That will be like doesn't cover all the requirements of the task in the band descriptors. So you have to have at least two reasons, and which is more than enough. Two is more than enough for 250. And how can people research this? Now this can be done with only one idea. Also, how can people research this? He hasn't said. How can people research this using multiple ways? So this can be done with only one idea. Now, first of all, I will write an introduction. Let's see. Okay. One's residence is a part of one's identity. People love their places of residence more than anything else. As a result, a trend toward learning the background of one's residence is growing in a few nations. Read it in your mind also.
Yes, sir.
Understood what I've written?
Yes, sir. Like now, one person residing in a place.
This is the introduction to the essay. Introduction. I have not answered any question.
Mm-hmm.
I've just given a start to my essay. One's residence is a part of one's identity. People love their places of residence more than anything else. As a result, now this is a cohesive device, as I told you over there. As a result, a trend toward learning the background of one's residence is growing in a few nations. That is what he was also saying, you know. In some countries, more and more people are becoming interested in finding out about the history of the house or the building they live in. I have not just only changed the words, I've given a background to the essay, like people love their houses, that is why it is increasing. But most people will tell you that you should be just changing the words. In a few nations, a growing number of individuals are becoming keen on knowing about the background of the residence they reside in. They will make you do things of this sort. But this is not a good start. A paraphrasing is not a good start. You should be writing more than that. You should be giving a solid start to the essay. Okay, which I based on the love for your shelter.
Right, sir.
Good. Now we'll answer the questions. First of all, as I told you, one paragraph should have one idea. So I've divided the two reasons. This is the introduction, only introduction right now, the first paragraph. But as I told you, one paragraph should deal with only one idea. So I've divided the two reasons into two paragraphs. Now let's see the first reason. And as I told you, one idea should be, okay, the ideas should be relevant. They should be fully extended and then they should be well supported. So let's see. First, my idea. A primary basis for this is prevention. Now I will explain it up to this point. Sorry. To be precise, sometimes buildings have defects that are not obvious. Nonetheless, they can prove to be dangerous in the long run. Getting information about the past of a house can bring forth such defects and thus prevent consequences. So do you get what I'm saying? As in, sometimes buildings have some defects, as in there might be a defect that is not known to us, but it could be known to people who used to live in it. So they, by knowing the history, we can know that this room has this problem, so we should repair it or something. This is the idea, that the reason is that, okay, primary basis, collocation. So a primary basis for this is prevention. This is my idea. Then I've explained it from here to here.
Yes, sir.
Understood.
And then
read it. Take your time. Yeah. No, you take your time to understand the explanation first. Do you get it? Like what I've written? Can you understand? Have I been able to explain the idea well, Isha?
Yes, sir. Like in the first sentence, it is written that
what my
basically it
thesis
is
is.
for basically the houses are for prevention, and sometimes we have to check that
No,
whether
wait,
building.
wait, 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 wait. Houses are not for prevention. As in, he has asked that in some countries, more and more people are becoming interested in finding about the history of finding out about the history of the house or building they live in. What are the reasons for this? Why are people, keen on knowing the history of their house? I have given that they want to know the history of their house because of prevention. Now I explain it. To be precise, sometimes buildings have defects that are not obvious. कभी कभी बिल्डिंग्स में प्रॉब्लम्स होती है जो हमें पता ही नहीं है. नन द लेस दे कैन प्रूव टू बी डेंजरस इन द लॉन्ग रन. आगे जाके नुकसान कर सकती हैं. गेटिंग इंफॉर्मेशन अबाउट द पास्ट ऑफ अ हाउस कैन ब्रिंग फोर्थ सच
सच
डिफेक्ट्स
डिफेक्ट
एंड
एंड
दस
प्रिवेंट
प्रिवेंट कॉन्सिक्वेंसेज. अब जब उन हाउस के बारे में पढ़ेंगे तो पता चल सकता है कि यार ये इस कहते हैं यहाँ पे ये प्रॉब्लम है तो सामने आ गया, तो उससे हम जो है अपने आप को वी कैन सेव आवरसेल्व्स फ्रॉम द कॉन्सिक्वेंसेज. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, वन ऑफ माई अंकल्स हैड नोन फ्रॉम अ वॉर्न आउट एज इन फटा हुआ थोड़ा सा ब्लू प्रिंट, दैट मीन्स ले आउट, दैट एन अनयूज रूम इन हिज हाउस वॉज इलेक्ट्रिकली अनसेफ. इट हैड सम मेजर वायरिंग इश्यूज. तो उनको पता लगा कि उनके घर में एक ऐसा कमरा है जिनके बारे जो यूज नहीं करते, लेकिन उन्होंने एक ब्लूप्रिंट देखा, पिछला मैप देखा, देखा उसमें तो वायरिंग प्रॉब्लम है, इन केस कोई बच्चा चला जाता तो उसे करंट लग सकता.
राइट सर,
श्योर ईशा, हैव यू अंडरस्टूड द फर्स्ट रीजन?
यस सर,
इट्स ओके इफ यू हैव नॉट अंडरस्टूड इट. दिस इज द फर्स्ट क्लास. इफ यू वांट मी टू रिपीट द थिंग आई कैन, डोंट वरी.
नो नो सर, इट्स फाइन. बेसिकली यू
फाइन.
हैव इन फर्स्ट लाइन यू हैव रिटन द
आइडिया.
कॉज
ओके
एंड आइडिया, एंड देन यू
ओके
हैव एक्सप्लेन दैट आइडिया लाइक दिस
यस
थिंग कैन हैपन and given a relevant example to it.
या एज इन दैट आल्सो सेड नो दी आई शो दैट टू यू अगेन वन सेकंड. सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल रेलेवेंट आइडिया, देन इट इज फुल्ली एक्सटेंडेड, देन इट इज वेल सपोर्टेड. दिस इज व्हाट द डिस्क्रिप्टर्स रिक्वायर्ड. नो इफ यू सी
यस सर, सर आई जस्ट वांट टू आस्क यू वन थिंग दैट कैन बी यूज एब्रीवेशंस इन दिस लाइक
डोंट
एग्जांपल, फॉर एग्जांपल लाइक ईजी
ईजी
और
नो
या नो.
दैट इज अगेन समथिंग नॉट एकेडमिक. दैट इज यू आर यूजिंग अ शॉर्ट टर्म, दैट मीन्स यू आर ट्राइंग टू बी इनफॉर्मल. यू आर इफ यू आर यूजिंग शॉर्ट टर्म्स दैट मीन्स यू आर बीइंग कैजुअल, एंड कैजुअल इज नेवर एकेडमिक. नो
यस सर,
डोंट राइट देम. ओके सो इफ यू सी हियर व्हाट बैंड नाइन सेज इज दैट presents a fully developed position in answer to the question with relevant, fully extended and well supported ideas. So that is what I've done here.
yes sir,
Sure.
the idea in the first line idea was written
Yeah.
and then it was extended with a proper logic and then an example.
Yeah. First I gave the idea, then I gave the links, what made my point relevant. And then I gave an example. Example can be fake, no problem. You can cook up an example, no problem, and to prove it. Okay. Sure. Icha,
Yes,
shall we continue?
yes, sir.
Okay. So then, if we see the second reason now, another cause of the residence-related curiosity is the benefit of warding off any legal issues. That is to say, one does not know about the former owners of one's current property. They may have linked the property to a legal procedure. Such a link can have future repercussions. Now, repercussions is fine because repercussions means you may think that you may think that in the earlier part of the class, in an earlier part of the class, I said repercussions. They will use repercussions, a fancy term, but they will use it unnecessarily when the repercussions. Term is inappropriate. Now it is fine that you are going to face something wrong in the future. You know the meaning, that is fine. As in sometimes it happens that people use it when they don't even have to. So another cause of the residents' related curiosity is the benefit of warding off any legally. Oh, sorry, we were at repercussions. They may have linked the property to a legal procedure. Such a link can have future repercussions. For instance, in the film Cat Hat, the protagonist comes across a fact that he has paid a very big sum for a mortgaged villa. Hence, if people know of such legal entanglements from the backdrop of their houses, they can stave off potential sufferings. So stave off is a collocation that means prevent. So the second reason that I've given is that there might be legal issue with the house that we do not know, and it was actually made to happen by the previous owner. So if we read the documents, if we get to know what the legal links are, we can prevent a problem. Like I gave a fake example again, making a fake film, that in that movie he pays for a villa that is already mortgaged. So now he has to get the villa out of that legal procedure also. Take your time and understand this, I would say, point. Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, Isha, have you understood the point?
Yes, sir.
Fine. The next question was that you have to tell a source for doing this. How can people research this? So let's see. The best way of learning the historical backdrop of a house is by reading official deeds. Whenever a house is built, bought, or sold, there are official legal documents that record the proceedings. They have a good account of whom the property belongs to, what its condition is like, and what its involvements are. To illustrate, the official papers of a house include the fact that the ceiling of one room requires reparation. So I've said that read the official papers. No, there are always legal formalities whenever a property is involved, whether it is built or sold or maybe given on rent. So you can read those, and those things have the current involvements and the problems or the conditions of the house. So by reading them, you can get to know what the condition of the house is. And an example that our house papers have this condition written that one, the ceiling of one of the rooms is not proper. So if you buy it, you have to have it repaired by yourselves.
Yes, sir. So basically in this third paragraph, you have written, you have given a general statement.
No, not general. As in if you see, first, we had to answer what are the reasons for this. And then there was one more question. How can people do this? I show you the question again once. If you see, there were two questions, no? What are the reasons for this? And how can people research this? I told you that reasons have to be two, at least two, because reasons. And it was a condition in the chorus and occasion part that you have to write one idea in one paragraph. So the first two body paragraphs after the introduction, the paragraphs, the first two were this, devoted to reasons.
The ideas? Yes, sir. And the third one
The first was intro. The second paragraph dealt with the first reason. The third paragraph dealt with the second reason. Now comes paragraph four, and it is going to deal with the second question, because reasons we are done with them. We've given two reasons, yes, more than enough. Now we have to answer the next question, which is how can people research this? And the procedure that I've told is that you can read the official deeds. Now I've explained it that whenever a house is built, bought or sold, there are official documents that record the proceedings. They have a good account of whom the property belongs to, or what its condition is like, or what its involvements are. And I've given an example that if you read the papers of my house, you will get to know the condition that the ceiling of one of the rooms is not right. So if you buy it, you have to repair it.
Yes, sir.
Sure.
Yeah.
Then comes conclusion. One of the ways to write a conclusion is that is what I use, but there can be other ways also. What I do in the conclusion part is that, which I used to do in my American course also, that you can always rewrite the body paragraph ideas in a nutshell. So I gave two reasons and one procedure. So in conclusion, people want to know about their residences for physical and legal safety. Now, if you see, the first was prevention, that means physical safety. The second one was legal issues.
Safety.
Moreover, official transaction deeds are a good source of this kind of information, which was my third body paragraph, this one.
Yes, sir.
Done and dusted. So this is how you write one of the types of the IELTS essays. For today, until our next class, what you have to do is that you have to go through the writing band descriptors. You have to read this essay again. And one small task regarding the reading test I'll send you, you can do it from the PDF only until your books arrive. So that will have hardly 13 questions. You will just give have a test of yourself, like how good are you at solving reading tests. Or you can print it out if you have a printer at home. So I'll send you a PDF, okay? Just solve that. You have to solve that, those 13 questions. When you are done with them, just send me a message and I'll send you the answer key. And you have to go to the band descriptors again and you have to read this essay again so that I am able to build your fundamentals before we move on to the more complex things. Fine?
Right, sir. Fine, sir.
Okay, this is the end of the class. See you tomorrow.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, sir. You can leave the class.